Macmillan Audio presents American Demon, Eliot Ness and the Hunt for America's Jack the Ripper by Daniel Stashower. Read for you by Will Damron. Prologue. The Last of the Good Guys. For about 3 years, beginning in 1936, Eliot Ness kept tabs on my grandfather, Fred P. Stashower. According to information in Ness's possession, Fred P. Stashower was an old egg-tossing vandal. This, I admit, was news to me. Eliot Ness, who rose to fame during the Prohibition era as the man who got Al Capone, kept tabs on a lot of people. His private papers, now preserved at Cleveland's Western Reserve Historical Society, feature a rogues gallery of bootleggers, rum runners, racketeers, and gangsters of all stripes. Scrapbooks from his Chicago days chronicle his storied career as the leader of the Untouchables, the legendary team of Prohibition agents who smashed up Al Capone's illicit breweries. Eight agents caught Capone, reads one clipping. Eliot Ness, on the spot, escaped death. There are also images of their famous battering ram truck, rigged up with a heavy steel plow to crash through the doors of the Alki kitchens that fueled Capone's multi-million dollar empire. There's even a newspaper artist's rendering of an enraged Capone swinging a baseball bat over his head, preparing to crack open the skull of a mob turncoat. Still, as I flipped ahead in the scrapbooks, it became clear that the Untouchables formed a surprisingly narrow slice of Ness's career. We're often told that there are no second acts in American lives, but Ness, whose career in Chicago ended at the age of 28, badly needed one. He found it, after a couple of years in the wilderness, as director of public safety in Cleveland, a position that placed him in charge of the police, fire, and building departments of America's seventh largest city. Most of the veteran policemen were cynical and didn't believe Ness was for real, one local reporter would recall. The politicians of both parties were sure he was an overpublicized tyro, a Boy Scout built up by the newspapers, who would soon fall on his face. There was reason to think so. Ness was the youngest safety director in the history of any large city, and he arrived in Cleveland at a particularly turbulent moment. The city had been an industrial powerhouse in the 1920s, but all progress halted as the effects of the Great Depression took hold. Cleveland coasted downhill at dizzying speed, a city historian would note. Worse yet, the Depression created a vacuum in which the underworld thrived. During the Prohibition years, Cleveland became a major hub of bootleg liquor and its sinister offshoots, including high-stakes gambling, prostitution, and racketeering. This, in turn, gave rise to a web of graft that ran through every level of the city's government and police force. Things got so bad, according to Clayton Fritchie of the Cleveland Press, that policemen were expected to tip their hats when they passed a gangster on the streets. From his first day on the job, Cleveland's new top cop chipped away at an entrenched system of bribes and payoffs. Ness took an aggressive, hands-on approach, insisting that he would not be a remote director, chained to a desk at City Hall. "I am going to be out," he said, "and I'll cover this town pretty well." Not only that, he promised, "I will do undercover work to obtain my own evidence and acquaint myself personally with conditions." In truth, the odds of Ness going undercover were slim. His face appeared on the front pages of the city's newspapers almost daily, making him easily one of the most recognizable figures in town. In case anyone missed the photos, reporters were quick to embellish, often dwelling on his boyish good looks. "He is about 5 feet 11 and a half inches tall, weighs 172 pounds, has a mop of unruly brown hair which he futilely attempts to keep parted," the press observed. His eyes are blue and keen, and his complexion ruddy. He is trim and athletic. He looks more like a collegian than an expert criminologist. His looks were deceiving. Day after day, for months at a time, Clevelanders awoke to read of some fresh feat of derring do from their young safety director. Ness had kicked open the doors of an after-hours gambling parlor while the city slept, or cracked down on an extortion racket, or rousted a crooked precinct captain. "There was never anybody like him," said one admirer. "He really captured the imagination of the public in his early years, and he was given a hero's worship." But there was one stubborn blot on his otherwise flawless record. Beginning in 1934, and continuing on Ness's watch, a string of brutal murders staggered the city. The killings were utterly without precedent, so grisly and shocking that they came to be called a real-life murders in the Rue Morgue. Though Cleveland had seen more than its share of violent crime, being nearly as mobbed up as Chicago and New York, these murders were chillingly exceptional. Each of the victims had been beheaded, some, it appeared, while still alive. The remains, in most cases, were painstakingly dismembered and scattered across the city. The horror took many forms. A pair of schoolboys would stumble over a headless torso, or a hacked-off section of an arm or a leg would be spotted floating down the Cuyahoga River, or a severed head would appear in a city dump. Each atrocity touched off a fresh cycle of fear, outrage, and calls for action, with thunderous headlines such as, "The Mad Butcher Strikes Again," and, "Who is this mad torso killer?" 50 years earlier, the entire world had recoiled as a series of horrific crimes unfolded in London's Whitechapel district. Now, it seemed, an unnervingly similar note of terror had been struck in America. "Cleveland's torso killer," read one national headline, "slays in same manner as Jack the Ripper." There were many parallels, certainly, but also troubling inconsistencies that posed a challenge to investigators. No pattern could be seen in the tally of the dead. There were men and women, blacks and whites, straights and gays. The victims, when they could be identified at all, were found to be indigents, drifters, or prostitutes, people who would not be missed. Some were known to have been living rough in the hobo jungles of Kingsbury Run, a dried-up riverbed that cut across the city's southeast side. This gloomy no-man's land, a patchwork of trash heaps, cooking fires, and pools of industrial sludge, served as the killer's hunting grounds. Cleveland's Detective Bureau launched a massive effort, putting in hundreds of hours of overtime. When conventional methods failed to bring results, they pushed themselves to devise fresh ones. A veteran detective named Peter Murillo even set himself out as bait, disguised in hobo gear, but the killer remained elusive. Many hoped that the investigation had reached a turning point when Eliot Ness took personal charge in September of 1936, but the scientifically trained investigator appeared just as flummoxed as the army of detectives under his command. 10 times in Cleveland a mad headsman has killed, and 10 times he has dissected with consummate skill the body of his victim, wrote a Cleveland press reporter at the height of the drama. 10 times, indicating skill at surgery or efficiency at butchery, he has baffled police so completely that today there is no tangible clue to the killer. What is he like, this ghoul who delights in cutting up the bodies of men and women, leaving legs and arms and heads and torsos to be found by small boys, bridge watchmen, chance passers-by? As the death toll continued to climb, Ness found himself besieged. "I want to see this psycho caught," he declared, but nothing in his training or experience had prepared him to track a serial killer. The phrase itself had yet to be coined. As pressure mounted, Ness grew edgy and frustrated. Capone had been nailed on a technicality, a strict interpretation of the United States tax code, the most rigid and banal set of rules in existence. This time, The rule book had yet to be written. Ness faced a criminal who not only flouted the law, but whose motives were only dimly understood. Here was a problem that couldn't be solved with a steel-nosed truck. For the past 3 years, I've had an Eliot Ness action figure on my desk. Also, an Eliot Ness transigram board game and a graphic novel featuring Ness and Batman. Ness, I've come to learn, comes with a whole lot of pop culture baggage. He's a maddeningly slippery figure, and it's often difficult to separate fact from fiction. Even the year of his birth is a subject of debate. Much of the hyperbole surrounding Ness springs from the pages of The Untouchables, a rock'em, sock'em potboiler of a memoir published in 1957, in collaboration with sports writer Oscar Fraley. The dialogue sounds like an Edward G. Robinson gangster flick. "We walked up to these goons, and that one with the shiner started for his Roscoe." Ness has been roundly criticized for the book's many exaggerations and inventions, but at least some of these embroideries originated with Fraley. Among Ness's papers, there is a copy of a long memo that he sent to his collaborator, laying out the background and incidents of the Capone case. The writing is awkward and scattershot, but over the course of a dense 23 pages, Ness gives a largely unvarnished account of himself and his part in the drama. He takes pride in the dangerous work done by the Untouchables, but he also provides a clear-eyed assessment of his role as a supporting player in a larger, multi-pronged effort to bring down Capone. By the time Fraley recast this raw material into book form, however, Ness had become the central figure of the campaign, a square-jawed hero who all but lassoed Capone from the back of a galloping horse. Ness expressed discomfort over the book's many excesses, but he did little to moderate them. By that stage, he needed the money. In time, The Untouchables provided grist for a wildly popular television series starring Robert Stack, and later, a landmark film directed by Brian De Palma from a script by David Mamet. These portrayals carried Fraley's extravagances to fresh, lofty heights. It may be sufficient here to say that the real Eliot Ness did not throw the gangster Frank Nitti off the roof of the Chicago Federal Building. More than 30 years later, however, everyone remembers that scene from the movie. He's in the car. It's easy to see why this version of Ness, a smooth amalgam of Dirty Harry and Atticus Finch, resonates so deeply with people. He's the embodiment of two-fisted justice, so much so that it's even claimed he served as the model for Dick Tracy, the straight-laced supercop of comic strip fame. Few people, myself included, are immune to this appeal. I grew up on the Untouchables TV series. Or, more specifically, I spent rainy afternoons watching fuzzy, flickering reruns on Cleveland's Channel 43. With the rabbit ears on our hot point TV carefully set to 10 and 2. The character on screen seemed inextricably linked to Chicago, as much a part of the landscape as Wrigley Field. I knew even then that Ness had a Cleveland connection, but the details remained fuzzy. I was born and raised in Cleveland. I delivered copies of the Cleveland Press from the basket of my Schwinn Stingray, and I still have my membership card for the Bernie Kosar Quarterback Fan Club, number 1064. That was a tough time to be a Clevelander. Our river caught fire. So did our mayor, the unfortunate Ralph J. Perk, who somehow set his hair alight with an acetylene torch at a metalworkers' convention. Mistakes were made. Still, when I went looking through Eliot Ness's scrapbooks at the Western Reserve Historical Society, I felt a certain amount of hometown pride. At first glance, his papers make for a strange mishmash, especially as the young Chicago gangbuster slides into a corner office at Cleveland City Hall. Intriguing glimpses of his police cleanup effort, with headlines such as, "Ness is Nemesis of Crooked Cops," are jumbled in with blueprints for a newfangled coin-in-slot Parker, later known as a parking meter. Oddities abound. There's a letter from the King of Hobos, thanking Ness for a lunchtime talk, and there's a sheet of lyrics for a children's song on safety awareness. A goof plays on the roof. Many familiar faces can be seen peering out from the yellowed clippings and bleached photos. I had expected to see the big-name gangsters. Scarface Al Capone covering the unsightly gash on his cheek with a handkerchief. Machine Gun Kelly hoisting his trademark Tommy gun. Alvin Creepy Carpus with his hands splayed to show the misshapen fingertips with his prints surgically erased.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.